Hello, ladies and gentlemen, and today on Mick Fucker's Garage, I start a vlog. Here's a rundown of the possible tools that you could use. And I have a cover right here that pops off that goes into my dash.
Yep, I got a leather.
Well, I guess. I see a lot of the YouTubers out there. They make vlogs and people watch them. They get a lot of likes and subscribes. I guess it's just like letting them into their personal lives a little bit. I won't share too much with you, but, you know, I'll share what I feel. I don't care anybody else knowing. Last time I tried to do this, my camera batteries died on me. It was only like 5 minutes in. This time, they say they're full. We'll see how it goes. So why did I start McFucker's Garage? Well, I see a lot of shows out there like Eric the Car Guy, Mighty Car Mods, Jay Leno's Garage, and there's a few others like Chris Fix. I can't think of them all right now, but I like to watch those shows, and I think it's neat when they give handy hints and tips. I also like the humor that they put into it, you know? I think humor is a good way to get your point across, because, you know, people are more apt to listen. Battery, you know, you gotta be bawling on there, basically. But I want to put my heart and soul into this show. I wanted to make it my own, and I wanted to make it a hit. I don't know what the possibility of that is. I'm just a guy with one camera, and I only get a few projects here and there. You might get more handyman projects than car projects, because I only get work on cars when people want something fixed that they don't want to take it to a professional garage for. I in no means call myself a professional. I always feel like there's always something new to learn. And I think that's the key. You gotta keep an open mind. Always gotta stay open to new ideas, that is. And then you can make your best judgment based on that idea and experience. Well, I don't know. Let's talk about my cars. How many cars have I had? Let's see. My first car was a 94 Plymouth Voyager van. That was my mother's. They gave it to me to use during high school. And then they gave me another car when we moved. They gave me their Dodge Neon 2001. Then after that, my first car that I ever bought with my actual money was a 1987 Dodge Ram B250 conversion van. That was cool. It had a bed in the back. It had a TV in it. I thought it was the shit. I even painted the word Shaggin' Wagon on it at one time. But that was the first vehicle I ever actually learned how to work on. And sure, I learned how to change a battery here or there. I knew how to change an air filter at that point. But that was when I actually started to learn how to work on things, when I started living on my own and didn't want to start paying out the wazoo for service that I knew I could do myself. So I started with oil changes, And then I got into it, and I was like starting to degrease the engine and making it, you know, just busy work. And then I broke my first stud on that truck, wheel stud. I was trying to get this rusty bolt, lug nut, right off the stud. And I over-torqued it too much. It hasn't been off in probably 3-4 years. Because I bought this thing sitting in a field, which I'll never do again. Not unless it's some hell of a vehicle. And I learned how to change my first wheel stud. On that particular model, you just took off the hub and you pounded it out with a hammer. I'm sure a lot of vehicles are like that. I've done that a couple things on a couple vehicles. And then the rear end goes in that thing. So that's my first rear end I've ever changed. And then I sold it soon after that. I actually got the rear end out of a 150, swapped the axles around, popped that one in. Somehow I ran out of oil on the interstate with that thing, and it sang its death song and dropped right on the highway. But we got it back. Oh yeah, I also, before all that happened, that was when I learned how to do brakes. How to do brake lines, how to change the pads, how to change the... Yeah, there was rotors on that. You know, rotors in the front, drums in the back. I could do brakes all day long, and I remember looking at drum brakes and thinking, what? I can't do that. But you can. It just takes practice and experience, learning, patience. I was lucky to have somebody tutoring me, mentoring me in the ways of the automotive force back then, and now we're just good friends. We turn to each other for help, but it's good to have that. But if you don't have that and you still have the urge, if you can read, or if you can't read, you know, there's books out there, and if you can read, you read it, learn up, try it, experiment. If you can't read, just have somebody read it to you. Or get an ebook or a microphone computer reader thing. I don't know, I'm not trying to make fun of people I can't read, so please don't think that. But, let's see, my next vehicle, a 92 Ford Taurus. It was turquoise, it was beautiful. I bought it off of my mentor friend that I just talked about a little bit. His sister was selling it, they got a new Cadillac. That car has been sitting in their dooryard for a couple of years, they weren't going to do anything with it. All it needed was brakes, and I paid $300 for it. It was mint. And when I mean like mint, I mean like showroom quality 92 Ford Taurus in 2005. So it was pretty cool. It was really nice, and that got me liking Crown Victorias and whatnot. It reminded me of them. And I just heard something. Oh, it's still going. The sad thing about that car was, after I did a lot of work to it, I had to change the front springs because they were old and they actually snapped, and it was like low riding. it wasn't no modification, it was low. And that was my first strut and spring change, shock absorber, whatever. I actually think we kept the shocks and just changed the springs. And we redid the brake lines on that one, bought new tires, they were all warped. But that thing was beautiful. I would still be driving it today if I didn't sell it back then. What happened was, I was driving on the highway going to Old Orchard Beach. Had it all loaded down with my friends and my girlfriend, which is now my wife. And we're driving down the interstate. We got all our beach stuff in the trunk. I got all my tools in the trunk. It was basically a driving storage shed. And we're driving down the interstate, 75 miles per hour. I go to pass a truck, and all of a sudden, I'm losing power. I'm hitting the accelerator. It's just over-revving. Nothing's happening. We're between two Mack trucks. Transmission fluid dumped right out. And we were in a rock and a hard place. So we waited around, we got a tow truck, my friends had AAA, but we only could go like 3 miles because it wasn't their vehicle. So we get to this place that was like Fucktard Garage or some shit like that. And he looked at my car like it was Thanksgiving dinner. He had a tow truck there. And I was like, look, could you tow our car back to our place, which is 60 miles away? And he's like, nope, but I'll buy your car off of you for $200 so you can pay a cab to go back. And I was like, look, we can give you the money in 2 weeks. And they're like, nope, sorry, I'm a jackass. And then we did the deal. I sold him my car. He took a tractor to it right in front of us after we got done loading it and smashed it right in. Just to be a dick. Big shit-eating grin right on his face. Whatever. You know, that was just adding insult to injury. There's a special place in hell for people like him. I would have not cared if it wasn't for the shit-eating grin and the cocky attitude. Well, after that, I was without a vehicle for a while. I actually had a motorcycle from my friend, and I attempted to ride it twice. I only paid $120 for it. It was a Honda CB750, 81, four-cylinder engine. To me, that thing was a beast. It was like taking a Honda Civic's engine and putting it between my legs, you know. I loved it, but I was too scared to ride it. So I fixed it up, turned around, sold it for $600, which I thought wasn't pretty bad. I'm actually thinking that bikes might be my calling. I'll look for decent enough bikes that can run and drive still, and I'll just, you know, give them some general maintenance and send them off their way. That's the plan, at least. I just got to get my hands on the bike and some startup money. But I try to talk about it with my wife. She says it's a good idea, but she's like, where are you going to get the money for a bike? Where are you going to get a bike? We can't afford that expense right now. And, you know, it's true, but I also feel like, how can I get started if I don't have any money? Why won't you help me? But I understand. I really do, because we got to take care of our family first. But it's all right. Well, anyways, after that, I bought another Taurus. It was actually not a Taurus. It was a Mercury Sable. This time it was a station wagon. Four-door station wagon, yeah. Same car, just 2 years newer, and it was a shitbox. A real shitbox. Paid $100 for it. Guy was nice to me. He's like, oh, you need a car? Yeah, you can take my shit off my lawn, basically. Oh, thank you, mister, thank you. It needed everything. But it still had a sticker on it, so I just patched up what I needed to stay safe. Yeah, I had a decent enough car. I actually got a couple years out of it. First thing that was bad right off the bat, I didn't look a gift horse in the mouth. The brakes, only one brake pad was grabbing, and I drove it from Clinton to Winslow like that. It was hilarious. Hilariously scary. It worked, but it was scary. So I got around on that, and I blew the transmission in that. Funny, huh? Rear end, transmission. Well, after that thing was gone, I got a 98 Buick LeSabre. No, it was a Buick Century. I thought that thing was nice. It was very luxurious, very roomy, very comfortable, very good on gas. But I didn't get a whole year out of it. We paid $800 for it. Had a sticker, didn't ask questions. Next year rolled around, we traded it in for a 2005 Ford Taurus station wagon. and that was nice. First newest car I've ever owned, ever got from a dealer, but it was still used, but it was nice. I lost my job, couldn't afford the payments anymore. I asked them if they could just hold off on the payments until I can get a job again, and they said nope. And then I said, okay, I want to voluntarily send it back. And they said, why? And I was like, I can't afford the payments. We don't want to do that. Can you drive it back to the lot for us? It's like, I can't even afford to brush my teeth. So they sent the repo man to come pick it up. I was like, look, I just need a few months. Well, after that, I'm back on my feet, and there was a bee that just flew by me. You can't act too scared with bees or they'll sting you. Most of the time, they'll leave you alone, but you know, he was just flying by. There's probably a bee's nest somewhere in here. Alright, well, anyways, after that, I get back on my feet, sort of. I have a job again. I get a pickup truck. You know, three-seater. Actually, this one was a two-seater. It was the 94 Ford Ranger. And it was rear-wheel drive only, had air shocks. Bought it off of a stonemason. It was a five-speed, four-cylinder engine with eight spark plugs. I thought that was neat. It had a strut mount go bad on it in the back on the frame. I had to cut it off and put a new one on. And that was a neat experience. I had to do that too on that Dodge truck. Come to think of it, on the Dodge van. But it's fun. It's okay. Well, anyways, I love that truck. I actually want to get another one someday. But it wasn't practical, because a day after I bought the truck, brought it home, got it registered, insured, and was driving it, my wife tells me she's pregnant. So that truck didn't last long. I turned around and sold it. I sold it to a crusher so I could register a Crown Victoria that I bought. You may have already seen it. I actually enjoyed that car after, but it didn't get good gas mileage, and the rear end blew on it, so now it's sitting in my backyard. I actually have it on hold, being sold to a friend for a lawnmower, weed whacker, and $300. How nice am I? And I paid $2,500 for it. But let's not talk about the Crown Vic. Back to that truck. That truck was nice. I got great gas mileage. It had like a 12-gallon tank, I think, and I got 400 miles out of it. And it was peppy. And it was a pickup truck. So it was cool. I liked it. I'll actually get another one someday. Maybe even the same year. I don't care. I don't know. Newer doesn't always mean better. But it depends on the shape, honestly. And where I live, they use this corrosive material on the ground during the winter that will dissolve your vehicles. And I think it's done on purpose, so the average Joe guy will be like, oh, I can't fix that. I better go to the car dealer and get my credit line reapproved and get a new vehicle. And, you know, I also noticed that people that are on the seat and the positions of government in our state are names of car dealers, so that's probably why that shit's on the road. I'm sure that's not their secret agenda, but whatever. Well, after the Crown Vic died, I went for almost a year without a car again. Had a kid coming, and another kid, actually. I'm actually on kid number two, and I have a kid number three on the way now. And I bought a 92 Ford Festiva for $500. It was a five-speed, four-cylinder, 1.3 motor. And that thing was insanely great on gas, but not practical for a growing family. I actually could put my two kids in the back seat, but guess what? Wife's pregnant again. So I need to get a third vehicle. Another vehicle. Sold the Festiva. Wish I didn't get rid of it. Wish I got rid of the Crown Vic, kept the Festiva. I would have used that thing to drive around town. But nope. For whatever reason, I kept the Crown Vic. Oh, because I thought I was going to fix it and have it running again. I didn't. I decided it was more practical to buy a third row seating Ford Explorer. I get shit gas mileage. I had a few problems. But it's a decent, nice vehicle. It's actually the first vehicle I've ever taken to a garage to have work done, just because I didn't want to do it in the middle of winter on the cold ground. I know what you're all going to say, but I had the means to take care of it, and so I did. And I honestly wish I didn't. Reason being was because when I went to the garage, they told me it would be one day, and I told them what I needed done. I didn't want them to go looking for more problems. I told them this is what needed to be done. And they go, "Oh, well, you know what? That really doesn't need to be worked on. But your inner tie rod ends actually do." I was like, "Oh, okay. Thank you. Thank you for finding that problem. I thought it was the other problem this whole time. Go ahead and fix that. Okay." So that was fun. I was cool with that. I actually thought it was ball joints and wheel bearings, whatever. I told them to change those, and they didn't. And whatever they did, it's still not aligned right, and I'm going to have to take care of that myself someday. I haven't done it yet, and I'm wearing tires as we speak. I'm just sitting here, and tires are just wearing. Well, anyways. I call them up. "My truck ready yet?" "Nope. Got a hole in the rocker panel. Cost you $30 to fix it." "Oh, okay, that's about what it would cost me to go get the steel down at the steel place." "Okay, go ahead." I know it's going to be plus labor, whatever. "Oh, we changed the other side, too. Just thought I'd keep it even." Did I approve that? No. And here comes the next part. "Oh, your muffler's not going to pass inspection next year." "It's going to pass inspection this year, right?" "Yeah, but next year it's going to be fucked." And they already had the muffler in a box in front of me, and they're like, "Yeah, we were just about to put it on for you." I didn't approve you putting on a muffler. "Well, you know, blah, blah, blah." They talked me into it. I let them do it. I guess I shouldn't have. But I got a new muffler on it. Whatever. They even welded it on. Alright, now here's a shit kicker. 4 days later, my truck ready yet? "Oh, yeah, oh, wait, no, your advanced track light just came on. Let me go try to clear that." They couldn't clear it, and they were actually trying to get me to buy a new module for it and everything. I was like, "No. Let's go see what we need to do to clear that code." The advanced track is just the a computer in the truck that controls the braking of individually of all four wheels. So when you're going downhill, it helps you somehow. Well, turns out that the reason why it wasn't working right was because the rear brake calipers were stuck. They were hanging, whatever. And I asked them, "Why didn't you notice this while you were changing my pads and rotors?" They just didn't. And I said, "Wow, that's stupid. So how much is it going to be to change those calipers for me?" "Oh, they're going to be $80 a piece, and they're going to be the blah, 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 plus whatever time we got to put in the blah, 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 blah." And then they're like, oh, yeah, say yes, say yes. Oh, you know you don't want to do that work yourself. Well, guess what? Winter was over. It was a fluke spring. like, all of a sudden spring just came within the 4 days of it being, like, waist-deep snow. So I said, you know what, I can do things myself. I'm going to go change those calipers. I ended up changing them $30 a piece without any labor time. I don't count my labor. I count it as free labor when it's me doing it. I know there's stuff that I'm missing out to tell you, but that was my experience at a garage. And if you have the ability to read, I strongly suggest that you do your own stuff or have somebody help you that knows what they're doing. But don't go to a garage. Garages are there for people to get screwed. Sure, there's a nice guy out there once in a while. But just because you don't know probably 90% of what you're talking about, they think they can walk all over you. But I know enough. I don't know what the percentage is that I know, but I know it. And you can take that to the bank. Well, hey, don't forget to like, comment, and subscribe. Thanks for listening to my little rant backstory. I hope you enjoyed. Have a good night, everyone.